the lost generation, the relentless suffering of Syria's children. Shelled less than 24 hours after a gas attack, today more young lives were shattered in a war without end. While in London, they tried to find a roadmap to peace almost without hope. Tonight, it appears the US Secretary of State has called off a trip to Geneva to discuss Syria with his Russian counterpart. Is there any prospect left for peace? Also tonight, keeping her Brexit cards close to her chest, when will Theresa May reveal her hand? Change promised at Sports Direct, and not just what Mike Ashley carries in his pocket. And Rio opens its arms again. The Paralympics get underway tonight.
This is ITV News at 10 with Julie Etchingham.
Good evening. There is barely a statistic from Syria which offers hope. A civil war which has now been going on for 5.5 years, nearly 500,000 of its people dead. And in all that time, despite numerous attempts, the world has failed to find a single route to peace. Today in London, a goal was set, a distant one, for a Syria of the future post-Assad. But whenever it comes, and it could be many months, even years away, it could not be soon enough. Certainly not for the children of Aleppo, caught once again in a reported bombing by President Assad's warplanes.
This morning in Aleppo, it wasn't the future of Syria they were concerned about. It was the present. Once again, hospitals were filled with the screams and sights of bloodied children and their relatives, caught up in a random onslaught which has literally lasted their entire lifetime. The Al-Sakri area of the city was shelled less than 24 hours after being hit by an alleged chlorine gas attack. The victims, too young to understand this war, this brother and sister begging to be taken to their injured father, part of Syria's lost generation, who so desperately need this conflict to end. The sickeningly familiar scenes of the scramble to save lives in a city encircled by Assad's guns, where not even the hospitals are safe. This fighting in Aleppo today shows just how intense and vicious the war has become. President Assad, backed by the Russians and Iranians, is more secure than ever. Their forces have a stranglehold on Aleppo. In short, people here feel today's peace plan amid all this is just a pipe dream.
We don't believe in politics anymore, but what we need is time. We need time that, like the new generation would have its chance. Like to have something different.
A world away in London, a blueprint for peace was being launched. The main Syrian opposition group, the Higher Negotiation Committee, posed with foreign ministers from around the world, trying to add credibility to a plan that even the most optimistic observers say is a distant goal.
The plan unveiled today by the opposition HNC is ambitious. Some would say aspirational to the point of being totally divorced from reality. There would be 6 months of negotiations with the Assad government to agree a temporary truce and then a full ceasefire. President Bashar al-Assad would then step down. Power would be handed over to a transitional administration. It's not clear if this would include jihadist rebel groups. This administration would then run the country for 18 months, hoping somehow to keep the peace between the warring factions. Then a new constitution would follow and UN-supervised elections.
It is a plan, a vision and a plan for Syria that is democratic, that is pluralistic, that will take that country forward.
But for now, the children of Syria can only contend with the cruelty of the current generation, cruelty that has brought them and their country to its knees. Dan Rivers, News at 10.
Well, while the killing has continued through those 5.5 years, the talking to end it all has been infrequent, to say the least. Official peace talks first began in Geneva in 2014, but they ended quickly when the Syrian regime refused to discuss Assad's exit. It took another 2 years for talks to resume, but these two were suspended after just a few days. In April, negotiations in Geneva collapsed again after the Syrian opposition walked out, whilst in Vienna, major players failed to set a new date for fresh talks. And despite long-running discussions between their secretaries of state, Barack Obama and Vladimir Putin, could not reach any deal at this week's G20 summit in China. Well, our international affairs editor, Raghi Omar, is here with me now. And just take me through, Raghi, what we've seen today and what you've made of it.
Well, I mean, where does one start? I mean, as Dan was saying in his report, I mean, if the high negotiating committee was, you know, on the gates of the presidential palace in Damascus, you know, forcing its way in and demanding, you know, President Assad, you know, leave the country, then fine, this would be a sort of worthy document. But it is, as Dan was saying, a million miles removed from reality. President Assad is more entrenched and more powerful than he has been at any single time since 2013, when fatefully the use of chemical weapons in the east of Damascus brought the United States and Britain to the point of airstrikes. That didn't happen, and he's been on the march ever since. Why would he agree to this? It's already been dismissed out of hand from Damascus as being a crazy idea. Is it playing to the gallery? Yes. I mean, you know, I think the Syrian opposition are mindful of a possible President Hillary Clinton. How will she see it? They're mindful of a Barack Obama at the end of his presidency. Will he do something rash and agree with the... So people are playing with a sense of trying to position themselves, but I just can't see any hope for this kind of situation.
I mean, even with President Obama perhaps trying to secure some fragment of legacy over this issue, you know, what prospect is there in the next few months?
There really isn't. I was talking about a week ago to a British diplomat and former intelligence officer who trained and learnt Arabic in Damascus, who said that, you know, this is, in humanitarian terms and diplomatic terms, a nightmare from hell. It is fiendishly complex. In the south of the country, just to give you an example, where British Special Forces are training Syrian opposition groups, there are 70 opposition groups in the quietest corner of the war near the Jordanian border. I think this is a situation where Syria, unfortunately, will bleed itself to a standstill, where every single person and group is exhausted. And that may take 5, 6, 10, 15 years. I cannot see any solution whatsoever. It's difficult enough trying to find a cessation of hostilities, let alone an end to the conflict.
It's a pretty depressing analysis, Raghi. Thank you. And indeed, yet another illustration of just how difficult it is to make any progress towards peace in Syria. A key meeting appears to have been yet again postponed. America's Secretary of State John Kerry and Russia's Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov were due to meet in Geneva tomorrow, but there is more confusion tonight about whether that meeting will indeed take place at all. Now, while we wait to find out precisely what Brexit means, the Prime Minister went some way to explaining the lack of detail thus far. Theresa May told MPs today she did not want to show her hand before proper negotiations with the rest of the EU take place.
Theresa May doesn't want to show her hand to the rest of Europe before she goes in to negotiate with the other 27 leaders. MPs here want to know what her plan is. But heading to the House of Commons today, she was keeping her cards close to her chest.
We will not reveal our hand prematurely, and we will not provide a running commentary on every twist and turn of the negotiation.
But opposition MPs sensed weakness and demanded more information.
This government is not concealing its hand. It hasn't got a hand, or it would appear a clue.
So far, we've just had waffle. So may I ask the Prime Minister a very simple question, but it's quite important. Does she want the UK to remain fully within the European single market?
Yeah. The Right Honourable Gentleman doesn't seem to quite understand what the vote on the 23rd of June was about. The United Kingdom will leave the European Union, and we will build a new relationship with the European Union.
But all we know about that so far is it involves controlling immigration and getting as many free trade deals as possible. And the uncertainty may be affecting business. Ryanair is building 50 new planes for next year, but now the boss, who always opposed Brexit, says none of them will be based in the UK.
I think it's very difficult for anybody to speculate on Brexit, since nobody has a clue what Brexit means or will look like, including the British government.
Now, a few less Ryanair planes are not an economic meltdown, but today the Bank of England governor said he stood by pre-referendum warnings from the bank's policy committees.
In light of all the events since the referendum, since the evening of the 23rd, I'm absolutely serene about the comments made both by the judgments, I should say, made both by the MPC and the FPC.
So the government is preparing for Brexit negotiations in an uncertain economic environment and under pressure to declare their negotiating strategy. And that presents quite a challenge for Downing Street, because even if Mrs. May can keep her poker face in the who knows how many months it takes for negotiations to start, she has a whole government full of ministers who may be less able or less willing to keep quiet. Brexit Secretary David Davis has already let slip views on the single market. Liam Fox and Boris Johnson are also outspoken Brexiteers. Tomorrow, EU Council President Donald Tusk will visit, also wanting to know what cards Mrs. May holds. Carl Dinan, News at 10, Westminster.
Joined now by our political editor, Robert Peston. So we had these dire warnings before the vote. The economy doesn't seem to have suffered as badly as some predicted. Theresa May not showing her hand yet. Does she have this breathing space, do you think? Or where are we at?
I think she's probably running out of breathing space. Yes, the economy hasn't melted down in the way that some proponents of us staying in the EU had warned. But, you know, let's not forget that the growth rate of the economy has halved since that vote. And there are lots of reasons to believe that we will bump along at this lower growth rate for some considerable time, and it could get a lot worse. You know, I was just in China with the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister of Japan, the President of the US, both warned her that enormous Japanese and American companies based in Britain who came here for access to the single market are losing patience with the absence of detail about what the trading future for Britain with the European Union will be. It won't be too long before we hear them say that jobs that they might have put in Britain will go to the continent, investment that they might have put in Britain will go to the continent. We are into a long, hard grind of potential damage to Britain.
And a key meeting potentially tomorrow morning with Donald Tusk. Do you think we'll get any sense of detail perhaps even emerging from that, or not just yet?
I very much doubt it, particularly after Theresa May today said that she wasn't going to provide a running commentary. And she has got a dilemma here. We haven't got that much leverage over the rest of the European Union. One area where she does hold a card, to use Carl Dinan's metaphor, is that they are desperate for us to get on with it. If she plays hardball and saying we're going to take our time, she will think she may get a better deal out of them. I just don't know whether that's true, but I had an extraordinary conversation today with a very, very senior business leader, and he said we are currently in a phony war. He made a very resonant analogy with 1939. He said it took 2 years after 39 for the real war to start, and he thinks that's what's happening this time. We've all got to hope he's wrong.
OK, Robert, thank you very much indeed for that. Well, as the owner of Newcastle United, Mike Ashley knows all about the anger that underperformance and missed goals can provoke. And he found himself under attack today over the way his company, Sports Direct, is run. Shareholders at the company's annual general meeting were demanding that he appoint a new chairman to reverse falling profits. Mr. Ashley said he needed a year to make changes. "I don't get everything right," he said.
You knew! Yeah.
Mike Ashley promises a new culture of openness at Sports Direct, and to prove it, he threw open the doors of the warehouse that landed the company in trouble. He was keen to show off the changes, not least to staff security searches. In his pocket, a wad of £50 notes, what looked like several thousand pounds worth. Well, he is a billionaire.
Clearly, I could have done a better job, but I didn't knowingly do it badly, and I certainly didn't deliberately do it badly.
Ashley's desire to right wrongs came too late to prevent a rebellion by the company's shareholders. Pension funds and insurers are unhappy with the slump in the share price. They filed into the annual general meeting to complain about the way the company is being run. Mike Ashley owns 55% of all the shares in Sports Direct. The rest are owned by independent investors. And today, just over half of them voted to oust the chairman, Keith Hellawell. But Hellawell is staying. He says to turn the business around, although he will stand down next year if they vote him out again. Keith Hellawell was once a successful chief constable with a tough reputation, but investors doubt his retail experience and his willingness to stand up to Mike Ashley. After the vote, the two men faced the press together.
If he's prepared to stay, I would more than welcome all his support, knowledge, efforts in making a helping us make a difference.
The point here, though, is that you and your board have spent years defending what you now accept was indefensible. If you were really, Mike Ashley, serious about change, you would accept your chairman's resignation.
I disagree with you. I think I am serious about change.
Rebellion over, Mike Ashley headed for home, his board of directors intact. The change he is promising is not the change that other shareholders want, but there's not much they can do about it.
And Joel joins us now from Sports Direct's HQ in Derbyshire, where he spent the day. Joel, do you think the boss, Mike Ashley, and Chairman Keith Hellawell, we saw there, will still be in charge this time next year? How are you reading it?
Oh, I'll be amazed if they're both not. Look, what we saw today was a power struggle. The independent shareholders did their best to unseat the chairman. They are fed up. They made it clear with the way that this company is run at board level, and they failed. Mike Ashley holds the controlling stake, effectively, in the company that, let's remember, he founded and built up since 1982. He flexed his muscles and he stayed loyal to his man. He will not allow other shareholders to pick and choose his board of directors. He will not give them the inquiry they want into corporate governance. If they don't like it, they are free to sell their shares. So far, so uncompromising. But remember, too, Mike Ashley today, I thought, sounded passionately and genuinely committed to change. Not the change shareholders want, but change he says will improve the lot of staff working in the warehouse here. Be cynical, OK, but we will judge him on what he does over the next 12 months.
They might have not got quite the change they want. Did he do enough to appease the shareholders, though, do you think, Joel?
No, Aviva, Legal & General, the big pension funds and insurers who invest our savings, incidentally, and have some of them, of course, invested in Sports Direct, are not appeased. They're not happy with the way this company is run. Shirebrook is, and the concerns here have been around for years. Their view is if the board did have something, an awareness about it, it would have smelt danger and headed this problem off at the pass. Instead, it let it fester and it's blown up and become something that should have been managed at an early stage. Their anger's directed at the chairman, but Mike Ashley is sticking by his man.
Joel, thanks very much indeed. The long wait looks to be over tonight for one of the two families still waiting to learn the whereabouts of their loved one after the Didcot power station collapse back in February. Police have located another body, although it has not been formally identified. Both families have been told. Now, taking the train to work was never meant to be so difficult, but passengers who use Southern Railway found themselves once again caught up in a major industrial dispute, and some say a political one too. Another 48-hour strike by members of the RMT Rail Union began today. At the heart of the dispute, plans by Southern Railway to end the role of guards on more of its lines. ITV News has seen a rail industry document claiming phasing them out would save the industry more than £2 billion over the next two decades.
More anger today with another strike, but the same issue. Are trains safe without guards? As the dispute intensifies, we've seen industry research showing guard redundancies could mean possible savings across the industry of up to £2.1 billion over 20 years, and that drivers operating doors should become the default position for all services. That worries some. Malcolm Chisholm has been a guard for 21 years.
Well, the problem with trains without guards are the problems start at the beginning of the journey, because then there isn't the second safety critical person there to ensure the train is dispatched safely. There's not somebody there to check and ensure that somebody isn't caught in the train doors or somebody running late doesn't slip down the side of the train.
Our research shows that of 28 rail operators, 12 now use versions of driver-controlled doors on at least some of their services. We've also found that incidents of passengers trapped in doors are rare, 37 in the last 15 years, but 40% of them were on services with driver-controlled doors, and of three major incidents causing serious injuries, all were on services where drivers operated the doors. Here, a passenger got her leg stuck between the platform and a train about to depart. There was no guard to help her, only a fellow passenger.
Had there been a guard there, he would have seen me because that was his job, and he would have stopped the train from moving off and come to help me.
The rail firm Southeastern Train says its driver was alerted by a passenger before his checks, which would anyway have ensured travellers were safe prior to moving off. And rail safety officials here have looked at evidence across the industry.
We found that there's no increase in risk to passengers from boarding or alighting trains operated by drivers alone.
But there's another issue. Some disabled passengers say removal of train guards removes their ability to travel.
A driver only train, they can't assist me to get off a train, they can't assist me to get on the half, they don't even know that I'm on the train and need assistance.
But train firms say many services with driver door operation do have a second worker on board to help passengers. This dispute about guards is also a battle over the future of rail, with neither the issues or the strikes likely to be resolved quickly. Chris Choi, News at 10.
Now, the fact that the number of tigers in captivity in China is growing would seem, on the face of it, to be good for the animal's long-term survival. But there is a sinister side to some of the Chinese tiger reserves, according to the wildlife charity WWF. It says they double as tiger farms, where the animals are bred to satisfy the illegal Chinese trade in bones and body parts. And ITV News has uncovered new evidence of that trade. There are now as few as 3,500 tigers in the wild, more than half the number 35 years ago. Relentless poaching has meant wild tigers now only occupy 6% of their natural habitat. But at the same time, the number of tigers in captivity has soared by 98% to 7,000 since 1994. Our China correspondent Debbie Edward began her investigation at a tiger park in the north of China.
Feeding the tigers is a highlight for visitors to the Harbin Tiger Park. Chunks of meat fed through the side of the tour bus. An opportunity to marvel at the animals up close. Tigers are big business here. This desolate parkland on the edge of the city, home to a growing captive population. It is, as remarked by one of the tourists alongside me, a bit like a prison.
The number of tigers in captivity in Asia is now more than double the population of wild tigers in the whole world. This park in Harbin is one of the oldest and largest where tigers are being farmed.
But the concern goes beyond the welfare of the animals. Tourist attractions are being used as a cover for the breeding of tigers and lucrative trade in their parts. At the souvenir shop in Harbin, they claim to sell tiger bone wine, which is illegal under Chinese and international law. Using a secret camera, we filmed this exchange with one of the sellers. We were sold a bottle of wine containing a piece of bone, a tiger claw, and a small piece of tiger beard. A single bottle can fetch up to £500. Tiger bones are said to have healing properties, offering pain relief and even a cure for conditions such as arthritis. The seller also offered us a tiger skin rug for £100,000.
Certainly they are illegal,
Dr. Xie Yan says profits are preventing the law from being enforced.
Too much money involved and too long history, especially the history have encouragement of breeding tigers.
The Harbin Park denies selling tiger bone wine and insists its tigers are bred for conservation. The evidence we gathered to the contrary will be used as part of an international campaign to stop tigers being bred for sale. Debbie Edward, News at 10, Harbin, Northern China.
After all the worries about budgets, ticket sales and, of course, the ban on Russia, the opening ceremony of the Rio Paralympics of 2016 is finally underway tonight. Let's take you to some of the latest pictures from there. The inevitable fireworks started just a few minutes ago after darkness had fallen across the city's skyline. And all those problems I was just mentioning there during the build-up. Burnt away in that amazing display of light over the Maracanã Stadium. 4,300 athletes are taking part and 264 of them are British.
In the city that does carnival better than anyone, tonight the Paralympic version is here. The opening ceremony at the Maracanã Stadium has begun in the last few minutes. A fusion of colour and music. A celebration of the sporting feats that are set to be achieved. But if the Paralympics is a showcase for disability, then this is normality in Rio. A daily struggle for Rogério Fajola. No ramps, no help to navigate far from his home in a favela, one of the urban slums that dominate the city's hillside. He told me how he's felt excluded from society ever since fracturing his spine in a bus accident 11 years ago.
We're scared to walk 100 meters. The pavement is so uneven. I suffer a lot. The authorities don't care and the people don't respect us.
There is the odd tangible change, raised sections of pavements, for example, to assist the blind. But the billions of pounds lavished on the Games means little to go around elsewhere.
People who wanted services to be provided to them and their money was spent somewhere else. And, you know, those kind of political things, sadly, you don't really want them to creep into Games time, and they won't, but it's the aftermath. I really hope that the Brazilian people can utilise these facilities.
Meanwhile, Rio's Minister for Disability, Carlos Rocha, who carried the Paralympic torch, acknowledges there's plenty to improve. He told me, do disabled people have difficulties in Brazil? Yes, they do. We've come a long way, but there's a lot more to achieve. This was the last practice for some of those dancing at the opening ceremony. They also performed at the closing version in London 4 years ago. But now they and hundreds of others are the ones taking centre stage, just like Brazil, just like Rio. After the troubled build-up of the last month, the hope is that the next 11 days will evoke a very different feeling.
And I'm very glad to say Richard joins us live now from Rio. So the opening ceremony's underway. How's it looking so far, Richard?
Well, it looks magnificent, and as ever, I think in Brazil, we can expect a huge party, not least from the International Paralympic Committee, who will be breathing one huge sigh of relief that these Games have even begun so well, given the chaotic build-up and the crisis that they themselves declared just a few weeks ago. Now, the opening ceremony is basically a sellout. Ticket sales are hugely up. But one thing interesting to note tonight is that the head of the International Olympic Committee is not coming to the Paralympics for the first time in more than 30 years, that is. And Thomas Bach will not be here. The reason we're hearing tonight, perhaps, is that police want to speak to him regarding alleged illegal ticket sales for the Olympics. So make of that what you will. But anyhow, now time to focus.
We'll stay with the Paralympics. Dame Sarah Storey, we've just seen there, will be trying to win her 12th gold medal. She's racing in track cycling. If she wins, she'll overtake another dame, Tanny Gray Thompson, as the greatest British Paralympian. And as we were discussing earlier, the Prime Minister will hold her first post-Brexit meeting with the European Council President Donald Tusk, a chance for both of them to discuss where Britain's relationship with the EU goes from here. Tom will be here tomorrow, but for now, from me and the rest of the team here, good night.